in the areas that they're walking, there's going to be heavy traffic, and it's going to slow movement of traffic and all that. So this artist from there apparently posted a video online ranting about this. And she was saying how disgusted she was that they were blocking the flow of traffic and all these things, and it started spreading like wildfire. People started criticizing her for being so rude and dismissive and condescending and all those things. And this guy wrote something about that, and he's explaining, you know, this men that you don't know if some of them are unemployed, others are sick, maybe they're having marital problems or relationship problems, family problems, whatever it is that's going on, they took from their time, from their lives, to do this because they are claiming to, they are calling to a higher power, yet you were disrespectful and all these things. And there's one part in here where this is what he wrote. He says, in times like this that are so traumatic, like those that we live here on the island, coming across an event of this magnitude gives a lot of hope, because it is evidence that there's people of faith that are making sacrifices and are capable of doing things to obtain divine grace. The people that in one way or another participated in this event are positive examples to imitate, because, and this is the part that got me, they had very clear understanding that it is only with your effort and your sacrifice that you reach God's grace. Yeah. And I was like, whoa, you know? That's not true, because we don't have to do anything to reach, obtain God's grace. And I started thinking about that. And one of the things that I was thinking was, when we talk to people about who God is and who Jesus is, we know that there's nothing that we can do that is going to make him love us more or give us more things, bless us more. Nothing. There's nothing that we can absolutely give that is going to increase what he's already given us, or he's going to give us at the moment where it's supposed to happen. So if we find people that have this sort of thinking in our path as a Christian, as we continue on with our lives, let's just show them the truth that we obtain God's grace because he is good and he wants to give it to us, not because of anything that we do. So I just wanted to share those things with you. It's something that really struck with me and made me think. And I'm very thankful that the things that the Lord has revealed to me as I started my path as a Christian, and as I've continued to grow and know him more and know of his word and understand, he's shown me, you know, there's nothing that you have to do for me to be good to you, but it's okay. You don't have to feel bad because you're good enough. So,
amen. Praise the Lord. You know, Roberto, that's exactly what Paul was trying to explain when he said that if it's by works, it's not grace. Yeah. It can't be both. Now, it's good that they do what they're doing, mm-hmm. because it's honoring God. It's you know, it's showing that they have a belief and a faith in God. But that's the problem, you know. Then the people like this artist woman, then she thinks it's about what they're doing that's getting them some kind of favor with God. And she's not going to do that, because obviously she's mad because they mm-hmm. disrupted her day.
Yeah.
And it's now she's got this image of God, which obviously is already distorted, or else she just doesn't believe.
Yeah.
And now it's even more distorted that, you know, God's not going to ever like her until she's willing to march, you know, 40 miles or whatever it is, you know, to get, you know, to prove that she's good enough to receive his blessing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's the sad part about it. The people that we most want to reach, we're turning further away by that kind of an attitude. So, good thought.
Yeah. Thanks. Any prayer requests or testimonies?
I lift up Cindy Rackus, her father, and her one of her eyes, and her
We'll lift him up. We'll rebuke it.
Amen.
Tim.
Yes, I just want to thank the Lord, you know, being with Leah and, you know, working through that situation and Friday, going to a doctor that replaced her other doctor that had passed away a year. We just want to be favored with the doctor and have a good doctor that would be with her. Because God uses doctors. I mean, he blesses them with the ability to diagnose and be there and be supportive. And thank the Lord for that. And also, I just thank the Lord for everything he does. Like, I was with a student today, you know, and you know, he was saying on this hand, you know, I got this happening in my life, but I'm still blessed, you know. And that blessed me, because sometimes you can think about all the negative things, but if you flip that around, realize you're still blessed.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the fact that, you know, when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, your life still changed. I mean, it changed for all eternity. And think about every day what he gives you. If he didn't give you nothing else, but he always does, he's still blessing you. You know, I mean, I remember just being where I couldn't walk because I went to the hospital, but I remember being able to take just one step, you know, and then two steps, and three steps, and then just be able to work again. And I think, I know I say it over and over again, but I just really feel that if we concentrate on the goodness that God does for us, and how many times he breaks us out. You know, we went downtown today, you know, and it was really busy, especially about 11 o'clock. And, you know, we're driving, and this is our, you know, first couple of days driving downtown. And it all flashed back. And I said, Lord, just never, ever let me forget that I was new. But I did the same thing. And I had to go in, because they always make the skywalks are shorter than they are. I mean, they're really tall. Mm-hmm. But they think they're about 13 foot. there, you know. Yeah, we're good. We're good. You know. And we wouldn't take it somewhere you couldn't fit under. Like,
yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Yeah.
But I just want to just thank the Lord. I'm so happy with how the Lord has just blessed our lives, and I just want to thank him tonight.
Amen.
Yes, Sheila.
So the lady that has lung cancer, I prayed for her today, and as soon as I walked in the door, she just couldn't thank me enough. And having prayed with her, she says that was like one of the worst days of my life. Literally, that day you came in, you don't even know what that meant. So I started sharing her, you know, healing stories and Jane's story, and she's like, "You think that lady would talk to me?" So I left a message for Jane to call her. So. Again, just grateful, you know, for the places and the opportunities the Lord sent us. Sometimes it's hard, but the Lord actually has a purpose and a reason for it. And who knows? You know, she asked me then where we'd go to church, and I told her we had a lot of healings and, you know, seen a lot of good, great things. So she was just really curious and just very totally different than last time I saw her. So just thank the Lord for opportunities and just continue to remember these folks in prayer that are still, she has a 12 and 15 year old, I found out today. I knew she had kids, I just didn't know their ages, you know. So she says, but I have a strong drive and a strong desire to live and a strong desire to live for the Lord. So keep her in prayer. Her name is Jesse. And thank the Lord that Miss Little Jayla is feeling much, much better.
Praise God.
Mother. Yeah.
John.
Yeah, I've also got this couple from work I've since
us stand. And let's come to the word tonight. Father, we thank you tonight for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us together here to be gathered in your name. You said, Lord, that where two or three are gathering your name, that's where you are going to be. That's where you are. We thank you, Father, because we know that you are our everlasting presence. You are wherever we go because you are in us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for all of the promises that you have made, that you have given us. The promises that you have declared are for us as fellow heirs of Abraham. We thank you, Father, because you have declared healing into our bodies, the manifestation of the divine healing that you have declared for us as your children. We call it right now for the lives of all of those that are in need of some healing, Lord. Those that are being oppressed by cancer, by joint problems, kidney problems, any sort of disease or ailment that is going attacking your children, Lord. We rebuke it right now and we bind it here on this earth. And we declare right now in Jesus' name that the manifestation of that healing is taking place right now. That will serve as testimony not only for those that experience that miraculous healing, that divine healing, but to the life of others that they get to go out and speak about the goodness of your glory, Lord. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your permission. We thank you for reminding us where we came from, Lord. Reminding us that at one point we were also beginning fathers. When we were baby Christians, we all come from somewhere. Guide us down this path that you have laid out in front of us, because you have a purpose for our lives, Lord. And we know that your will is manifested on this earth and in our lives, Lord, as it is in heaven. We thank you, Father, for your goodness, for your wisdom. We thank you for all the good things that you do in our lives that we get to share with others, the good things that you do in the lives of others that they get to share with us as we all come together and gather in your name. Share this testimony and serve as encouragement for each other and for those that we go out and encounter out of this world when we walk out and we put them in our path, Lord. We thank you, Heavenly Father, because you have given us the understanding that what we get from you, your grace, Lord, we get it not because of our works, but because of our faith in you, and you give it to us willingly, Father. There is nothing for us to do except receive it. Stand in agreement and rest in your Lord. For every good and perfect gift comes from above, Father. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Lord, we honor you. We lift you up. We bless you, Father. We thank you for everything that you do for us. Thank you for giving us your word that we get to speak into our lives, the lives of those that come into our path. When someone asks us, we pray and we agree and we stand with them in agreement with their need that they have, that they are presented to you, Father. And we know that you will take care of every need. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us here together to gather in your name. Let your Holy Spirit flood this place. Let your glory be manifested in this place tonight, Lord. That we get out of this place better than we came in. Pick up my shield and my sword at home. All right, announcements. We're going to have Mexican dinner after service next Sunday. If you're like me, make sure that you bring a bib so you don't spill it in your shirt. It's probably going to happen. Anyway, let's pick the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. John, would you be so kind?
Brother Robert does double duty opening service and leading worship tonight.
Press forward,
bro. Press forward. Triple duty. Yeah. Do the scriptures here in a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Was it the third week, ladies' night off?
Yeah.
We're gonna. Roberto doesn't know it yet. James doesn't know it yet. We're gonna shift a little bit. Shoot some testosterone around in this place on Wednesday nights in the next few weeks. Something's up.
Amen.
If it makes you uncomfortable, that's okay. I'll get over it.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
This is the realm of your glory, this is the realm of your grace. I can feel your mighty power, it is moving in this place. Thank you. wrinkles glory on the wind. Like a voice of many waters, I can hear the angels sing. Singing holy, 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 holy. Place tonight. This is your realm. And we know that your Holy Spirit, Father, it's being poured in this place right now. Thank you, Father. I praise you, Lord, for your creation.
I have felt the wind blow, whispering your name. I have seen your tears fall when I watched it rain. And how could I say there is down beneath the stars, is there your presence there? How could I stand at the ocean shores and feel the thundering breakers roar? To walk through golden field of grain, the endless blue horizon plays. listening to the river run, felt the ring of fragrance of the rose in bloom, a new corn cry at birth. How could I say
in your word, Lord, that out of our bellies there will flow rivers of living water. And right now, Father, we want to let that river flow. Thank you, Lord. The lost man say, I am found in him. Let the river flow. Let the blind man say, I can see again. Let the dead man say, I am born again. Let the
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Roberto. The worship team. Praise God. No, thanks to all you guys. Great job. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God's good, isn't he? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Roberto, I want to start at Mark chapter 8, and we're going to read verses 34 through 37. Mark 8, 34 through 37. I saw her out of the corner of my eye, and I thought, there's somebody else over there besides Sheila. I just caught a glimpse of it, and I thought, where was that? He was dancing in the spirit on all fours. Praise the Lord. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, the gospel and the gospels, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? If you will just go back to verse 34. Now, when you read that, it sounds great. It sounds spiritual. It sounds kind of like what the guy said that Roberto was talking about in Puerto Rico. But if I try to deny myself by myself, I actually focus on myself more than ever, right? So it becomes counterproductive. And self is the problem, not the solution. The point of this passage, not to try harder, is to shift our focus. As I was talking about Sunday, I'm not going to re-preach that message, but see, if we really are going to deny ourselves, then we have to be preoccupied with somebody else besides ourselves. Right? Praise the Lord. That's why, in like in marriage or any love, you know, we say it's 50-50, but everybody knows that it's 100-100, or maybe 150-100. Praise the Lord. But you know what I'm saying? In order for it to work, you're always denying yourself. But how do you do that? You don't deny yourself by saying, oh, boy, I can't do this, or I'm not going to have that. You deny yourself by focusing on that other person, right? Because that other person is more important than your immediate, you know, think you have to do or have or what have you, right? So this is the where we get hung up here, is we think that we're denying ourselves. That means I got to focus on me not doing or having or being or whatever, but in fact it's actually about focusing on Jesus. And if you look at this and read this carefully, you'll see what I'm talking about, because he said, when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. So he has bookended that very demand with himself. Right? He's really not talking about us giving up stuff. He's talking about, let's make the focus me. If whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. It's really more of, you know, trying to get us to focus on the Jesus than it is on what we're doing. Praise the Lord. So it's framed by this focus on Jesus. So if we want an abundant life, if we want the life of the kingdom, the life that's found in Jesus, then we need to stop thinking about us and focus on Him and His love for us. How much He loves us. Praise the Lord. So let's go to Psalms 139, and we won't read through the whole thing, but I just want to give you maybe the first, whatever you can get on the screen is fine. Psalms 139, that whole book or that whole chapter is about God's knowing us in every part of our life. So when you look at how He says, I see you're standing, you're lying, search me, Lord, know me, thou knowest my down sitting, mine uprising, thou understandest my thoughts far off, thou compassest my path, my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways, for there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. On and on and on and on and on about God knowing the most intimate details of each and every one of us, right? Amen. So God knows our thoughts, our actions, even the number of hairs on our head, amen? He loves to follow our lives. If you read these scriptures in that context, He watches us when we sleep, it says. If you go on, here it talks about us lying down, but another place He says, when I arise, He's still with me. So He's watching us when asleep. Now, it sounds kind of creepy in a way. You know, I don't necessarily like to have people watching me sleep, but this is God we're talking about. Amen? So actually, it's comforting if you think about it. He's always there. He's always aware. He always knows what's going on. Ever have weird dreams, a bad dream, a negative dream? God's right there with you. You wake up and it's like that was real, and all of a sudden it takes you a few seconds to kind of clear your head and realize that was just a dream. Right? But God was there with you all the time, even in the dream state. You know, He knows what we're thinking. He knows what's going on in our heads. And so God has no ulterior motive in any of this. It isn't like we think of a human, you know, stalking us or preying on us or watching, waiting for us to screw up or make a mistake or do something they can blackmail us with or whatever. No, He just knows us intimately. So He doesn't have any ulterior motive in this. It's not like He's waiting to get a chance to smack us down. He isn't some kind of control freak, amen, trying to manipulate or intimidate us into obedience. He just knows us and loves us. Praise God. God is in pursuit of us even when He says to follow me. Follow me, right? This is what we just read a moment ago in Mark chapter 8. Well, he's saying follow me, but the truth is we think we're following Him, but He's actually in pursuit of us. He's always there. I am your shield and exceeding great reward. I will be your reward, right? He's always around us and surrounding us and behind us, before us, and in us. Praise the Lord. He's not pursuing us. He's not there, amen, in order to punish us or to shame us, but He's there to rescue us, to embrace us, to love us. And you say, well, you know, we know that. But is that what we relate to other people? Because people, and I'm in the middle of two messages here, so I'm thinking about Sunday because I got a bunch of stuff going on this week and I got to make the things fit. Praise the Lord. You know, when I'm trying to prepare messages and stuff, but so I've got other things in my mind, but part of that is that, you know, we don't see Jesus as, I mean, I'm just speaking for myself sometimes, because of the way religious teachings take place, we don't always see Jesus as somebody we can relate to. I mean, He came as a man. This is God in the flesh. But it's hard for us to think of Him as another guy, you know, as another human being. And that's the way He wanted to define Himself. Right? Somebody with a personality, not something far off and distant. It's not like, you know, Einstein, you know, is pretending to be a 10-year-old, so he just adds 2 + 2. You know, it's not like Rembrandt paints, you know, with some finger paints on something and then tells us to put it on the refrigerator when we know that he could paint this masterpiece. No, he limited himself to humanity. He didn't ever function as God. He He limited himself so that he could not operate as God in this earth. We need to realize how much he wants us to be able to relate to him. Or he would have came as God and just done it, whatever it was he wanted to do, right? So I'm just saying, he's in pursuit of us. God loves us for who we are. He was one of us. And in fact, he still is. Jesus is still a man in heaven. He's raised from the dead, glorified, resurrected, but still a man seated at the right hand of God, flesh and bone. Praise God. He loves us for who we are. No conditions. No strings attached. I'm talking about once we become believers, once we put our faith in him. Now, he loves even the sinner. He died for the sinner. They're not saved just because he loves them. They have to accept his love. They have to accept his grace. But it's there for everybody. And the moment they do, they're in perfect standing with God. Now, we know that we've got issues. And we know we've got weaknesses. And we know that each one of us, and I'll speak for myself anyway, have dark corners that nobody sees. Praise the Lord. Now you can spend the rest of the night trying to figure out what mine is. But you know what I'm saying. We've got issues. Everybody's got them. We're human beings. Adam and Eve, look at this. Genesis chapter 2, if you will, Roberto. Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. And the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, Of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now, I don't know about you, but over the years I've thought about that and wondered why. Now, I understand now things that maybe I didn't understand years ago, but this is good and evil. God wanted us to be innocent, wanted us to remain innocent, which is what Jesus has provided for us through redemption. He has restored us to innocence. Amen. That's why we're perfect, because God sees us, just like Sheila sees this little baby, innocent. She can't sin because she's innocent. She doesn't know wrong from right. She doesn't know good from evil. She's a baby. And that's how God relates to us in Christ, is innocent. And we'll always be innocent before God. We have been declared innocent in the court of God. Amen? In the heavenly courts, praise the Lord. So my question has been over the years, why in the world did God even put the tree there in the first place? They were innocent, right? So why put it there? Why not just make it impossible to disobey him? Don't put something there that will cause them to choose. But the thing is, love, by definition, requires the ability to choose. Otherwise, you're a prisoner, or you're a slave, or you're in bondage somehow. Only by choice do we have the capacity to demonstrate love. Praise God. If we can't choose to love or not to love, then we really can't say that we love at all. The opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is selfishness. Adam and Eve chose self over love. God is love. God doesn't have love as an attribute. He is love. And they chose themselves instead of love. Selfishness is the essence of all sin. If you think about it, every crime, every evil has selfishness at its roots. Think about the contrast between Adam's selfishness and the love of Jesus. For God so loved the world, he gave. Praise God. So the entire Bible is really the story of God's love for us. It's not about sin or performance or religion. It's about God and His love for us, His creation. John 3:16, He says, "For God so loved the world that He gave." He wasn't selfish. He gave the most precious thing that He had. Amen? He chose to love us, regardless of the cost. And it's love on such an irrational, illogical level that it's hard for us to comprehend. No matter how many times we look at the love of God and all of its various manifestations, it becomes more and more difficult to fully understand it. It's more incomprehensible than algebra. I took algebra 3 times. I took it twice in high school. I took it once in college. I never did know what I was doing. To this day, I don't know. His love is more incomprehensible than that. His love is more incomprehensible than quantum physics, which I like to talk about but don't understand at all. I can parrot it from something I read, but I don't really get it. I don't understand how it works. And probably the epitome to me is the love of God is as incomprehensible as a woman. Praise the Lord. I don't mean that in a negative way. I just mean I don't get them. Praise the Lord. I don't always understand them. I think them to think like me. That doesn't work. Praise the Lord. But let's look at this. Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 37. And I'm glad they're not like me. They would be redundant, wouldn't they? Praise the Lord. Mark 8, 34 through 37. And when he had called the people unto him, who with his disciples also, he said unto them, "Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" See, the answer to living a selfless life is not gritting your teeth and trying harder. It's not hunkering down and putting more self-effort, because self-effort is doomed to failure. It's putting your confidence in Him and in the gospel, which is grace, the gospel of grace, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, we're expecting less of ourselves and ending up with more of ourselves when we try to do what religion has basically tried to teach us over the years. It's like New Year's resolutions. I gave up on those long ago. I never make them anymore. I used to when I was younger. But the truth is, they're not really resolutions. They're emotional suggestions. Give it a couple of days, and we're not doing what we said we'd do. So it's just a question of whether I can discipline myself to do what it is I resolve to do. But I don't really resolve to do it, or I would do it. So it's really not a resolution. It's just a suggestion that I make to myself to make me feel better about where I'm at. So you can't reduce the teaching of Jesus to New Year's resolutions. Because it won't work long term. And believe me, I've seen this ever since I've pastored, even before I pastored, when I was first saved. I saw the people come. I was one of them to the altar, make vows, make promises, repent, and a few days later, you fail again. And when I pastored here, before I pastored this church, when I was still in the denomination I was in, and I pastored a church in Ankeny, I preached all over the state of Iowa, and multiple times here in central Iowa and in the city of Des Moines, and I saw the same people from the same churches continuously coming to the altar, continuously being defeated, continuously being disappointed in themselves, ashamed and condemned, and to eventually, many of them, to just leave in what they used to call backsliding, which was really nothing more than just burdens that they could not bear and could find no relief from it because the church didn't provide any except their own hard work and their own resolving to not fail again. Praise the Lord. Again, don't try harder. Shift your focus from you to Him who has done all things well. Praise the Lord. So we lose our lives. How do we lose our lives? By forgetting ourselves. By taking the focus off of me and remembering Jesus and His finished work. I lose sight of myself and I see His perfection. That's what he's talking about here. John 15, verse 9. This is an incredible scripture to me. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. That is an amazing word from the Lord. As much as God loved Jesus, that's how Jesus loves us. That's mind-boggling. It's probably the greatest hindrance to experiencing God as God wants to be experienced is condemnation. And that's why the devil uses it continuously against us. The word condemnation means guilty verdict. You know, like the condemned murderer. It means that there's a guilty verdict, and now you're under condemnation of that verdict. If we are in Christ, our position, our status before God is righteous and innocent. Can't be anything else. Let me close with this. Luke chapter 15, verse 21 through 24. And I say these things in a lot of different ways, but I'm convinced. It's like Tim says multiple times, and I'm grateful for it, how much we should appreciate God and what God does for us. This is how we can do that. This is how we can understand the depth of His love, the commitment that God has made to us. How can we ever not be grateful? How could we ever doubt that He would do what is best for us in any situation, no matter what it looks like? That will free the church to do the works of Christ. That's how Jesus operated. He knew the Father's love. He accepted the Father's love. He lived in that position. And he tries to get us to understand that just as my Father loved me, that's how I love you. That's the freedom that sets us free. That's the thing that allows us to operate in the Spirit as children of God, with the authority of God. So the Son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. We know this is the prodigal son, right? But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Praise the Lord. When we sin, when we fail, the most powerful place that we can be is enjoying God's love, experiencing God's love, not moping in the corner, not beating ourselves up over the mistake we made or the bad decision or the behavior, amen, not making a bunch of promises or empty vows that we're not going to be able to keep. It's reveling and rejoicing in the never-ending righteousness of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I'm leaving you with this tonight. Party like the prodigal. That's the word from God. That's the word from Jesus. Party like it is 1999 forever. Praise the Lord. No, party like the prodigal. Party in the love and the goodness and the grace and the overflowing blessings of God. Not based on our behavior, but based on His goodness, His love, and commitment to us as His children. And life will be different. Hallelujah. It's the only way we'll ever experience the abundance of God is if we're willing to party like the prodigal. Can you say praise the Lord? Praise Amen. The Lord. Give God a big hand clap. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Amen. You're dismissed. See you back here Sunday. Bring your appetite. Yes. Praise the Lord.